Well, hello and welcome to the North Texas Teen Book Festival, the virtual version this year. My name is Melissa Prycer, and I am the president and executive director at Dallas Heritage Village, which is a history museum just south of downtown Dallas. And the way I got into museums was through books, and it was historical fiction, not the textbooks that you read in school. So it is my great pleasure to be with these authors today that are writing books to inspire young people to get involved in history and keep that going. Normally, we, of course, would be coming to you live from Irving, Texas, which for me is a short drive, but a plane trip for many of those that are on the call. So at least we don't have to worry about coordinating travel and all of that good stuff. So I'm here with some wonderful authors with a very wide variety of books that they have written both recently, and then some of them have pretty deep lists. So what I'm going to do to start things off is let each person introduce themselves and just let us know what book that we're going to be focusing on today. And so I'm going to start with Alan Gratz. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah. Hey, I'm Alan Gratz. I'm the author of a bunch of different books, but the one I'm here to talk about today specifically is Ground Zero. It just came out this month. It is brand new, and it is a story of 9/11.
All right, Jennifer, just kind of going around the...
Just moving around. I'm Jennifer Nielsen. My book comes out, it's just like out now, like the ink is still drying. This is Rescue. This is a spy tale in Nazi-occupied France during World War II.
Okay, Eden.
I am Eden Royce, and this is my debut novel, which is Root Magic. It is set in 1963. During an incredibly turbulent time in the American South. And it is a tale of fighting against racism, monsters, human and not so human, and learning about your ancestry and your own personal family's magic.
Great. And finally, Stacey. No, not finally, because we have David still too. Okay, Stacey next.
All those books sound so good. I can't wait to read them all. The one I'm focusing on is Luck of the Titanic. This comes out in May, and this is about a British Chinese girl who boards the Titanic in hopes of convincing her brother, her twin brother, who is a Chinese seaman, traveling there with a company of Chinese seamen, to restart their acrobatic act and go to America. On the Titanic, there was actually someone who's connected with the Ringling Brothers Circus. And so her hope is to audition for him and reunite her family.
And finally, David.
Hey, so I'm David Bowles. I'm a writer and translator and poet from Deep South Texas. Write my own books and have written and am in the process of writing historical fiction, I'm actually here to promote a book I translated and expanded. This is the Sea-Ringed World, Sacred Stories of the Americas, which was originally written by Maria Garcia Esperon, a Mexican writer. And Levin Querido hired me to translate and expand it. I added a couple of more sacred stories, and it basically takes a look mainly at Latin America, but also indigenous stories from the rest of North America and Canada, like the continental United States and Canada, recounting these like really essential and very moving historical / mythological / legendary stories from different indigenous cultures throughout this continent, or these continents, depending on how you look at it.
So David, a question for you, because I was going to go in alphabetical order by last name, and then this is how this has worked out. translation, I am terrible with languages, but a translation, that has got to be a very different kind of mental activity and also just a different kind of process than when you are writing your own novels, your own stories. I know you have a couple of series that you do. So how was it different from your usual process, and how did it work out your brain?
Yeah, well, I mean, usually if I'm translating, I'm translating just, you know, something that an author has written from Spanish or like other languages I know, like Nahuatl, indigenous language from Central North Mexico, just directly into English. But with this book, the process is complex because I had to think about the source material that has been adapted into Spanish, and I'm translating into English, but I'm going back to the source material, often, you know, recorded in English by anthropologists or whatever in like the 18th or 19th mm-hmm. centuries, but sometimes written in indigenous languages and so forth, and trying to find ways to not only translate the Spanish into English, but to, as much as possible, reinforce my translation with that original text as much as possible, so that I'm being faithful not only to the Spanish, but also to the original right. story of these of whatever particular native nation I'm working with. So it was like multiple layers of it worked my brain out really, really well, I tell you. And then I recorded the audiobook, because one of the interesting things is obviously there are lots and lots of names, lots and lots of indigenous names that are probably difficult for most people to pronounce. And wow. they were looking for somebody to do the audiobook. They asked me for recommendations, and I go, I don't want to wish that job on anyone, because the poor fool who gets to try to pronounce these names in multiple indigenous languages. I said, I tell you what, I'd be down for doing it if y'all want to hire me, because I have studied multiple indigenous languages. And they're like, oh, would you please? So I did it. So that was like one more layer. Like, how do you then take this translated, you know, this translation I've done from Spanish into English where I filtered in indigenous stuff, and now read it out loud, since most of these stories were oral to begin with, and make them resonate for a modern reader. So it was a lot of fun, but it's not for the faint of heart. It was some crazy work, but I loved it.
No, very, very different style. And that's part of the reason why I want to start off with your book, is because it is a little different than the others as far as style. So Alan, when I saw your latest book, that of course is a story of 9/11, my first thought was, wait, that can't have been 20 years ago. And that was a historical event that I remember as an adult experiencing, and my adult life can't be historical fiction. That's just not possible. But then I started thinking about the conversations that, you know, you've done a lot of more recent history in your body of work. And so what kind of conversations are you hoping to spark between children and the next generation that may be remembering these events and their own personal experience with them?
Yeah, this might be the first time I've written historical fiction that happened during my lifetime, which makes me feel very old. But my daughter is 18 years old. She is a freshman in college. She was born in 2002. She was born the year after 9/11. And when I was asked by kids, I got so many requests to write a book about 9/11. And I kept putting it off and kept putting it off, partially because I didn't know if I wanted to go there emotionally, you know, because I was an adult in the United States when it happened, and knew this was going to be a tough thing. But then when I realized that 2021 is the 20-year anniversary of 9/11, I thought, well, if I'm going to tackle this, let's try it this year. It was kind of a stunner to me to realize that this is the 20-year anniversary. It feels like it was both yesterday and a million years ago in some ways, because of all the things that have come between it. So for me, one of the big things is, of course, to tell young readers about that day. I mean, let's look, if you're in elementary school or middle school or even high school, you weren't alive for this. And I've even heard from young adults. Now, I'm not talking about the book category young adults. I'm talking about young people in their 20s. Who were alive during 9/11, but were in grade school. I mean, they also didn't really understand the gravity of the situation. And I was being interviewed on the radio by somebody who told me he was in third grade when it happened. And it kind of blew my mind that I was talking to an adult who, you know, was still a kid then. I want to show kids what happened that day so they understand why it's so difficult for so many of us who lived through it as adults to talk about it. But at the same time, I also knew that I could not just write a book about that day, because the message of that day was at the end of the day, Muslim terrorists are coming to kill us. And that day they were, but that hasn't been the story in the 20 years since then. In fact, we have many, many more pressing issues facing the United States and the world today. That hasn't been the narrative. And I thought, I can't write a book where that's the final message of it, because mm-hmm. That's not a message I want to leave anybody with. So that's why the other half of the book is set in the present day. It's told from the point of view of two different kids. One of my kids is a boy who's in the North Tower when the first plane hits and has to try and survive. And the other story is from the point of view of an 11-year-old Afghan girl whose village becomes the battleground between the United States and the Taliban in the present day. And she goes through her own version of 9/11 that parallels the boy in the towers. So for me, I want kids to understand what happened that day, but I also need them to understand how that day changed the United States and changed the world as a consequence. We are still fighting in a war, the war in Afghanistan, that began the month after 9/11 because of 9/11. Mm-hmm. That is now officially the longest war in US history. And unless something changes, we are going to have an anniversary for the 20-year anniversary in September for the attacks. And in October, it will mark the 20-year anniversary of the beginning of the war in Afghanistan.
Time is both long and short. So Stacey, to go back a little farther in time, your book, of course, is about the Titanic, and I will confess that when I was 11 or 12, which is pre-Leonardo DiCaprio movie, I was obsessed with the Titanic and read everything I could get my hands on about it. And so when I saw your book, I was the 11-year-old me that is still inside. I was very excited. And then as I was reading about it, I saw the line in your promo that this is also based on recently uncovered account of six Titanic survivors of Chinese descent. So then my historian, grown up historian heart went pitter-pat, because I always love when those uncovered, you know, you think you know everything about a topic, and then these uncovered stories, especially when they're about people that are so often underrepresented in our history. So what can you tell us about how those stories were uncovered? What can you tell us about that little piece of the uncovering and how you ran across it also?
Yeah, I was like you. I loved the Titanic growing up, and I thought it was just so fascinating because there's so much to mine, the wealthy and the poor and who survived and who didn't. I mean, that just so many ripe stories there. I did not know there were Chinese people aboard the Titanic, like probably all of you didn't know that growing up, because that certainly wasn't something that that was in the common knowledge. There were eight Chinese seamen, and they were being, as far as we know, they were being seconded. They were being transported to a new route in the Caribbean. They worked on a steamship. And so, in fact, six of them survived, which was a very high survival rate for the third class, which was more like 25% for the rest of the third class. And it was postulated that, you know, how did they survive? Why did they survive? Maybe they didn't speak English, perhaps, so they didn't hear or understand the orders, which were chaotic anyway. And they were just trying to, you know, survive the best that they could. And because listening to those orders would have meant a certain death for a lot of those third class passengers. But unlike the rest of the survivors, who were brought into the US without having to pass Ellis Island or do any of that immigration paperwork or go through any of those steps, they were immediately sent to Cuba. And so they had survived this, you know, this awful tragedy, but still they had to leave. America had shut its doors to Chinese people through the Chinese Exclusion Act. So they weren't allowed or treated like the rest of the survivors. And in fact, they were actually villainized in the papers. There were a few accounts talking about the Chinese as being the ones who hid under seats and things like this. And it was a little crazy how they portrayed them, maybe like dressing up as women and things that were blatantly untrue, but that was really the only mention of these Chinese. And in our culture, face, the idea of face and pride, family pride is a big thing. So a lot of these men, we don't know anything about them because they didn't tell their family and they were sort of like shamed for surviving. They were shamed for surviving in the newspapers, but they also, it was a cultural like, oh my gosh, I went through this experience and I survived. And that's like, that's so shameful. So they don't even tell their children. And so there were these documentarians, British documentarians, I think, who decided they were going to try to figure out what happened to these Chinese guys. And they put this call out on social media. And really, people started digging into their family histories and were like, I know grandfather came over on that on a boat. I wonder if it was that boat. And so eventually, they were able to uncover some stories, the actual stories. That documentary is not yet out. I think the pandemic, for some reason, has stalled that release date. So we still don't know exactly what happened with them. But my story is historical fiction, and it's more an homage to these men who history forgot about. Yeah, and I think it was fascinating discovering. And actually, in the James Cameron movie, he had a scene that was cut. Where there was a Chinese guy floating on a raft at the end. So it was known, but definitely no one made it. Yeah, a big deal of it.
Wow. Well, the fact there's a documentary coming too, like that's another thing to be excited about. So Titanic lovers rejoice.
Yes.
So Jennifer, you are also tackling a story that gets a lot of treatment in a lot of ways. World War II, there are so many World War II novels out there and so many stories about World War II. I kind of sometimes have that experience where it's like, oh, it's another World War II novel. But then there's just so much that's being uncovered. So talk to us a little bit about your newest, because I know this isn't the only World War II work that you've done, and just how it fits into that overall genre of World War II stories and what makes it a little different.
Sure. You know, I feel like, you know, we call the generation who fought and lived through World War II, we call them the greatest generation. Mm-hmm. And we call them that for a reason. I think it's because what they were able to accomplish and achieve is just really fantastic. And I firmly believe that if you talk to anybody who went through World War II, every single person has a unique story to tell. Rescue originated with my fascination with the SOE, which was the Special Operations Executive in Great Britain. They were like, Winston Churchill called them the League of Ungentlemanly Behavior. They were the Mission Impossible of their day. So it was the people you sent in who the government would be like, oh, they blew up that port? Well, we don't know anything about that. And that was the guys they sent in. Well, at the time that the SOE is created, there was a shortage of silk. Silk needed to go, you know, to the guys in battle. And here these SOE agents, these brand new spies, demanded silk suits. And they wanted silk maps. Like, this is a silk map of occupied France. And they wanted this silk. And people would be like, no, there's a shortage. Why should you get this nice silk suit? And they would say, well, it's because silk doesn't rustle against the skin. And so we have to carry a cyanide tablet with us. If we're caught by the enemy, we've got to be able to hide that cyanide tablet. And then everybody began to understand just how dangerous work for the SOE was. And they're like, no, have your silk. that's great by us. But what's fascinating, I set this in Vichy, France, which is the part of France where it wasn't where the Nazis were. My character has to get in to where the Nazis were. But Vichy, France wasn't any better. Especially, I mean, if you were Jewish then, they were as awful to you as the Nazis were. Or worse. And so it's this fascinating time. And so it involves Meg Kenyon, who meets a downed SOE agent who's injured, and she's got to make the decision of whether to complete his mission, because if it's successful, it will result in the rescue of her father. It gets into secret codes and the deciphering of them and the way they really were, which I've always been fascinated with codes. But here's where it got really cool for me. So I've been studying all this and writing about all this. Meg's mother is a radio operator for the resistance, which had to have been by far one of the most dangerous jobs. If you were a radio operator from the time you started, the average length of your life is about 6 weeks. It was that dangerous. And this is what Meg's mother is doing. And so last week, I'm on a call with a man in Montreal who lived in Vichy, France. And the man next to him, the home next to him, had a radio operator. And he's explaining to me how his neighbor stayed alive. And it was this great reminder that all of these things that we read about and study about and write about, that actual people lived these lives. And that is where history is just so fantastic. So yes, there are other World War II stories, but I firmly believe every single one of them matters because it is somebody's story who has not yet been told.
Absolutely. Well, Eden, first of all, congratulations on your first debut and all for young people. That's always exciting. So
thank
I know
you so
that
much.
It's set. Now show it off again. I know that it's set with the Gullah Geechee culture in Charleston, South Carolina. And I also know that a lot of people probably have no idea how that is special or unique or different. So tell us a little bit more about that, why that setting and that culture is so important to your story and how it shapes your story.
Gullah Geechee people are descendants of the original people who were enslaved in Western and West Central Africa and brought to the United States, or to the now United States. These were people who were captured because of their knowledge. The grain coast of Africa is where a lot of these people were taken from. So they were taken for their knowledge on how to grow crops. And when these people were enslaved and brought to the United States, one of the biggest crops in South Carolina at the time was rice. And these people were brought here for that knowledge, and they were brought to clear out swamps to plant rice. They were acres and acres of this rice land, and the weather was incredibly, incredibly, it was perfect for rice, but for people to be out there for 10, 12, 15 hours a day, planting and harvesting and clearing fields, it was incredibly difficult work, incredibly backbreaking, ruinous work. And because of that climate, so much of those ancestral ties to Western and West Central Africa were preserved because those people stayed in that area. Gullah Geechee people stayed in what's called the Gullah Geechee Corridor, which currently extends from about Wilmington, North Carolina, down to Jacksonville, Florida. And because the community was so insular, people that were slave owners felt like, we can't be out here. We can't be out here with this weather. So they left a lot of these people that had been enslaved when slavery was at its height to be able to hold on to some of these traditions. And looking at some of the food culture, some of the musical culture, some of the instruments that we as Gullah Geechee people use, some of our handicrafts, like sweetgrass baskets, all of that can be traced back to West and Western Central Africa. So we are a link, a living link back to the continent. And I set Root Magic on one of these sea islands that's off the coast of South Carolina, which is called Wadmalaw. And these sea islands were a place where people owned land. A lot of it was heirs' property. They inherited it from people that had previously owned them when they were emancipated at Juneteenth. Mm-hmm. And slave owners moved away from the American South because of the incredible heat. And they found it really difficult. And because these people were able to inherit this property, they were able to hold on to their culture and keep those ties strong. Mm-hmm. So Root Magic is set in 1963, which is an incredibly turbulent time, not only for the American South, but for the United States in general. Civil rights is, the movement is at its height. There's a great deal of violence. There's a great deal of people that are working and striving to make things better for Black people in the country. There are people that are actively fighting against that as well. There are church bombings, there are riots, and there's this island off the coast of South Carolina where integration has not come yet. Integration did not come to South Carolina until 9 years after the law passed to integrate schools. South Carolina was the very last state in the union to adopt integration. So Jez and Jay are contending with those changes. In addition, they're of an age where they can now start learning about root work, which is another ancestral tie to the African continent. And a lot of those practices that are able to protect people, protect valuables, protect property, those things are were frowned upon, and people that were enslaved were not able to practice those things. They had to do them in a clandestine manner. They had to hide and practice them. And anytime you do something where you have to hide it from someone, other people that are on the outside looking in think, well, you're doing something wrong and you're doing something negative. And part of the reason that I wanted to write Root Magic is when you look at root work and hoodoo culture, so much of it in the media is portrayed as an evil, negative thing. And that isn't how I grew up with root work. So a lot of my research was talking to my ancestors who are still alive. And I was lucky enough to be able to talk with my mother and parents and grandparents and other family members who still remembered 1963, who still remembered a lot of what people went through on the island, a lot of the persecution for people that not only were Black, but also practiced root work. And that dynamic between people who were root workers who would be alienated from even other Black people that didn't practice it because it was seen as such a negative, negative rituals and seen as almost an anti-religious thing to do. So I was lucky enough to have people very close to me to ask for their stories and thankfully be able to put them into Root Magic.
You know, one of the things that just struck me that really ties all of your books together is that need for one generation to pass those stories on directly. You know, history is not just what we learn, you know, in school or at a museum or things like that, but it's also what we learn from our elders, directly from our elders, and that passing down is so important. And so since I know this is part of Educator Day, I'm just reminding all of the students that are watching with their teachers that they need to talk to their parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and all that good stuff about these stories, because if 2020 has taught us nothing else, I think, you know, we've made that joke so often about how we're living history right now. You know, this is, we've always, you know, everyone has lived history at some point. And so it's important to have those conversations. So before I move into student questions, I want to do a quick lightning round and kind of shake us up a little bit. So the way this works, I'm going to throw you a question and it's supposed to be quick answer, and I'm going to trust y'all to not talk on top of each other. because that is harder to do this way. But so the first question is, what is the book that sparked your love of history? So to give you a chance to think, mine was Anne of Green Gables and Little House on the Prairie.
Mine was A Swiftly Tilting Planet by Madeleine Ingle, because Charles has to travel back in time. And even though the book is very problematic, it was the thing that got me really interested in that. Yeah.
Red Badge of Courage, loved it.
I'm going to say something more recently written, although I love those older Red Badge of Courage, all those, but L.A. Myers, Bloody Jack series, 13 books, awesome heroine, totally got me into the historical fiction mindset.
Nice. I think,
I don't have an answer, it's okay too.
I think I read Bronze Bow, I think in seventh grade, and it was about ancient Rome. And that sparked an interest that led me to foolishly take Latin in high school as well.
I think mine would probably be Edith Hamilton's mythology, because yes, I loved those stories and how they reflected the culture of the time as well as myth and legend.
So, historical figure that you would most like to have dinner with?
I would like to have dinner with Tlacaelel, who was a counselor to like five different Aztec emperors. He was basically the architect of the Aztec Empire, and he was a counselor for like 50 years, and so he had a huge influence, and he was a brilliant man who would be like really fascinating to sit down with and eat.
And then you can have some Aztec food to go with it and really shake things up.
I would like just to do a group dinner with the women who instituted the women's suffrage, the vote for women. What the women had to go through and endure in order to secure the vote for us is staggering to me. And I would love to sit down and hear their stories.
Well, for mine, now she's a part of history, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I'm such a fan of her and always wanted to meet her. So in my fantasy, it would definitely be having dinner with her.
I think for me, mine is also fairly recent. Muhammad Ali. I would have loved to have met Muhammad Ali and sat down. That would be fascinating.
Mine would be Zora Neale Hurston. She's a folklorist and a researcher who just decided that she wanted to hear people's stories and just got in her car and just traveled the South, got on a plane and to Haiti to just collect stories. And I just love that. And I'm sure a lot of those stories didn't quite make it to her books. So I would have loved to sit down and listen to those.
Well, great. Well, we have some questions from students that submitted them in advance. So yay to you for doing that. If you missed that opportunity, you should have done it. So Jessica from Jasper High School. So what we're gonna do, and if you just wanna jump in, and I'm not gonna do the thing where you all have to answer, because you know that sometimes that works well on Lightning, but not always. So Jessica from Jasper High School asks, when writing historical fiction, particularly about sensitive subjects, what are your personal ethics regarding editing and or editing out or adding in people or events?
I would love to start with this one, if that's all right. Years ago, I released Resistance, which is about the Jewish teenagers who fought back during World War II. And as I was working on it, somebody taught me something that I thought was incredibly profound. They said, you know, there's people in this world who deny that the Holocaust ever happened. And so if I get one little fact wrong because I haven't done my research properly, then that person can say, well, she made this up. Maybe it's all made up. And so I think about that every time I sit down to do research, that I can set a fictional story, but if I'm going to put something into my books as fact, it has got to be fact, because I will not give license to somebody who wants to create a denial of what history was.
Anyone else want to jump in on that?
Jennifer said
that's a great answer. You may not want to follow her.
I mean, I will say it is very important to, when you're weighing how much creative license to take, to consider the kind of hurt you will cause to people. So if I'm going to change history, even a little, I'm going to really be weighing it. One thing I did, for example, in Under a Painted Sky, which is my first book, about a Chinese girl traveling down the Oregon Trail with a runaway slave, is I moved the mountains a little bit, and I didn't think that was going to really hurt anybody. You know, I did move the mountains because it was necessary for a plot point. It would have taken them forever to get to those mountains and get lost in those mountains. So for me, that was an okay license to take. But for sure, it cannot do harm or erase people. So we're always, I think we're all, as historical fiction writers, very aware of that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What is it, Stacey? If you can't get to the mountain comes to you. So I guess that's kind of what you did with your characters. I'm paraphrasing, but I will tweak things a little bit. As Jennifer said, you have to be really, really careful about that because the past is a fact. What happened is a fact, and if you play around with that too much, then you get into that murky territory that she talked about. What I do when I do play around with things just a little bit is I use my author's note to explain what I did. So I would always, in my author's note, be sure to say, okay, I talked about Operation Paperclip here, which was the secret operation to collect up German scientists after the war and bring them back to the United States to work on our own missile and rocket program. And that was countering the Soviets. And I might move that up a little bit in time, just like moving a mountain a little closer to your party. But it was a real thing. And I try to get everything about it right. And then in my author's note say, oh, by the way, I moved this up by a year so it fit in my story, but it really would have really kicked in about a year from now. So anything I do like that, I want to be really clear about why I tweaked it.
So I have another question from Alondra from Britain Elementary, and this is actually just to David, so sorry to the rest of you. She wants to know, is My Two Border Towns about when you were little?
No, My Two Border Towns, kind of like they call me Güero, does maybe tap into, you know, what it was like for me as a kid living on the border. But it's definitely set in the present, and it's about the kinds of things that kids right now are facing on the border. So it's informed by the fact that I was a Mexican-American kid growing up on the border with family on both sides. And it maybe emotionally it taps into that, but like the actual plot and the specifics of the story are all set in the present. Yeah. So I mean, that's a great question.
Okay.
That's one of the things that
Michelle,
when you're writing about something that's similar to your own past in the present, there's like this strange murkiness between the two. Yeah.
Right. So Michelle from Austin Middle School asks, and this will be interesting because I know some of you are much further back in time than others. And we already know the answer for some of you on this as well, but I'm still going to ask the question. Do you ever interview anyone while writing about historical events, and do certain people inspire your stories? So I can guess some of your answers, but others may want to share. Eden, we know you talked to your family. Was there a particular story that really set you off on the path that you took with Root Magic?
Well, it wasn't a particular story, but I have family members that are root workers, And I enjoy movies. So watching movies, I would see these such negative portrayals of what root working was and how it was this incredibly evil thing done by evil people for no real apparent reason. And that wasn't how I grew up with root work. And it started me on the path of, I want to portray this magic practice with some more authenticity instead of the way it's historically been presented as such a negative, detrimental thing. So that was sort of what started me on the process of writing the book. But I also interviewed my mother, if you want to call it interviewing my mother, because she was a social worker in 1963 on Wadmalaw Island. So she was talking to the people that are in this book and asking questions and trying to make their lives better. So that was where I started my interviewing.
Right. Alan, did you do interviews, since yours is one that there's a lot of people you could talk to?
You know, I didn't do interviews on the 9/11 part, but I read accounts that people had written about their experiences in the Twin Towers. Because it was such a monumental event in American history, much has been written about it, books and books and magazines and documentaries. And so I was able to hear firsthand accounts from people who had been through those experiences that had already been documented. And I used those. For Afghanistan, of course, I wasn't able to speak to people in Afghanistan right now, at least people like my main character, Reshmina, in Eastern Afghanistan. But I was able, through my connections at UNICEF, because I wrote Refugee and I do a lot of work trying to raise money and awareness for UNICEF. I contacted them and I said, can you tell me what you guys are doing in Afghanistan? And they said, we can do one better. We'll put you in touch with our team in Afghanistan on Zoom. And I was like, oh my gosh, yes. So I spoke to their group in Afghanistan over Zoom, and we talked about what life is like right now for people in Afghanistan during the war, and especially for children, because that's right. UNICEF's focus. So that was an incredible insight into that world as well.
So Caden from Jasper High School, submitted a lot of questions. Good for them. what was the most interesting thing you learned about your topic or your period of time that you wrote about? And I have a follow-up question. What did you wish you had been able to figure out? Because I think that's one thing that I know it took me college to figure out, that sometimes you cannot find the answer anywhere because stuff wasn't saved. So
I can't hear you.
We missed, I think, a little bit of the end of your of what you asked.
Very last.
Okay. Question is, what's the interesting thing that we learned or that we wish we could have learned, but we weren't able to find the information?
My personal follow-up is what you wish you could have figured out, but were unable to figure out.
Oh. Okay.
Because the answers aren't always there.
I'm going to start.
Go for it.
Well, I learned a lot of things about the Titanic. And I was very hesitant to do this book, actually, because I don't know anything about shipping or sailing. And trying to understand how a boat worked was just a big black hole for me. So I actually had to order the blueprints, study them, and understand how shipping works. And that was a process. But I learned that there was one bathtub for all of third class. And I thought that was really interesting, but apparently they didn't really need to bathe, or they didn't really think about bathing too much back then, so that was okay. I mean, so many interesting things, trivia like that, but of course the one thing that we all still do not know was exactly how the Titanic sank. How exactly did it break in half? Was it like the movie? And I think this still continues to fascinate us to this day. Exactly what happened? Was it the iceberg? I mean, I still come across stories that say it was some sort of comet or something. Nobody really knows definitively what sank the Titanic.
Anyone else want to jump in on that?
I thought it was fascinating learning about the spy gear that they would have had back then, and stuff that, you know, it seems also James Bond right now for us, that they were really doing, you know, how the pen, you'd have a pen that was an explosive, or they would find dead rats and like plant them with explosive devices and then leave it, you know, just in a warehouse or something because it would get passed over. The other thing I thought that was fascinating is they were building a fake Paris so that when the bombers would come, that there was like, they're building an entire fake city. I thought that was unbelievably strange and cool, and it, like, which is even cooler.
Like a real size city, or?
Well, they're trying to you know, just outside of Paris. And then what they'd do is if they spotted bombers coming, they would order a blackout order. And if you didn't black out your lights, they'd throw rocks through your windows as a reminder of you're gonna black out those lights. And then they'd light up the fake city to be like, hey, look, it's all bright over here, come bomb this. And yeah, just a crazy, strange, real thing.
I think we've got time for one more person to share any research gold or research disappointments.
For me, I also, much like Stacey looking up schematics of the Titanic, I had to look up schematics of the Twin Towers. Mm. I needed to know where every stairwell was. I needed to know where every elevator was. There were 99 elevators in each of the towers. 99. And so I had to know where they went and where the communal floors were. There were sky lobbies partway up, because you couldn't have elevators that went all the way to the top and all the way to the bottom, because you'd wait forever for an elevator. So they put them in blocks. And so many people were trapped in elevators. And there are some mysteries about what happened to certain people in the buildings that we will never know. There were survivors who went to try to go to the office next door to see if the person was all right, and the room had collapsed, and they don't know if they were in there when it happened, or if they were out of the room. So there were the fates of many people were not known. So I wish I could tell those stories, because those are stories that are untold. They didn't survive. We don't know what happened to them. And I wish I could be a voice for them, but there's no record of those. Whereas there are other records of people who called out. The phones worked in the Twin Towers for almost the entire time, the landlines. And so people called their friends and family, they called 911. And those are firsthand accounts, many of them from people who did not survive, that I was able to use.
Right. Well, thank you all. I know we could keep talking, but you know, there are time limits on these things. For those of you that are watching, if you have any comments or other questions, please use the hashtag NTTBF21 or to rave about it and tell your friends, because this will be posted and available for a while. And so we can, you know, help keep this conversation going. And I'm sure, I know many of these authors are on Twitter themselves, and probably might even, you know, pay attention to that occasionally. If you need to buy a book, which I'm sure you need to buy more than one book, so you may have to wait for some of these, NTTBF is partnering with bookshop.org, which is one of the independent vendors. So bookshop.org/shop/NTTBF, and then that way it'll help support the festival so that the festival can keep going, whether virtually or in person. There's also swag available. We have two of our authors wearing the NTTBF t-shirt right now. Look, there they are. There is swag available on the website. I think you probably know the NTTBF website because you are here watching this now. But yes, SWAG also helps support the conference, and this could not be done without the support of a lot of wonderful people in the city of Irving. Keep watching. This is not the only panel. There are other panels. They're probably just as fabulous. Who knows? But keep watching, keep reading, and keep doing that historical research. If nothing else, I hope that this is a reminder that history is, in fact, fun. I promise you, this is what I do for a living, and this is what they do for a living, too, only in different ways. So thank you so much for being a part of this and watching, and I hope you enjoy all of their books and all the other panels that are a part of NTTBF 21. So thanks so much, and we will see you at some point. Bye.